To ensure a thorough assessment, it is best to perform the musculoskeletal exam of the hip in a systematic way. The following is a suggested order of exam that incorporates the common techniques for diagnosing hip injuries. Begin the hip exam with inspection. Observe the gait as the patient walks away and towards the examiner, looking for an antalgic gait, Trendelenburg, or pelvic wink gait types. From an anterior view, assess for alignment of shoulders, iliac crests, and knees. Observe body habitus and look for lower extremity atrophy or skin changes. From a posterior view, again assess for asymmetry, atrophy, or skin changes. Look closely for spinal lordosis, scoliosis, or paravertebral muscle spasm. To evaluate for lumbar causes of referred hip pain, check back range of motion. Flexion, extension, lateral flexion to the left and right, and rotation. The Trendelenburg test assesses for hip stability. The examiner sits behind the patient and places thumbs in the posterior superior iliac spines and hands on the iliac crest to check for level height. The patient then stands on one leg with the raised, unsupported leg flexed at the knee and hip. In normal function, the unsupported pelvis elevates slightly, indicating the gluteus medius muscle appropriately abducts the supported hip. If the pelvis drops on the unsupported side or remains level, it's considered a positive Trendelenburg, indicating a weak gluteus medius or intra-articular pathology in the supported hip. The standing flexion test assesses for lumbosacral, sacroiliac, or pelvic dysfunction. The examiner stands behind the patient and places hands on the iliac crests with thumbs over the inferior notch of the posterior superior iliac spine. The patient slowly flexes forward. If the posterior superior iliac spine moves more cephalat on one side, the test is positive, indicating dysfunction. The same maneuver should be repeated with the patient seated, known as the seated flexion test. In the seated test, the patient should have feet flat on the floor, shoulder width apart. Again, the examiner notes the PSIS positioning on the patient flexed forward. If the PSIS moves more cephalat on one side, the test is positive, indicating dysfunction. The stork test evaluates for a stress fracture of the pars intraarticularis in the lumbar spine. The patient places hands on hips and stands on one leg and hyperextends the spine. Pain in the lumbar region is considered a positive test. Next, examine the hip in the seated position. Observe for range of motion with internal rotation and external rotation. The fulcrum test evaluates for femoral stress fractures. The examiner places one arm beneath the patient's femur. A downward force is then applied to the femur distally. Pain is suggestive of a femur stress fracture. With the patient supine, a femoral log roll, internally and externally rotating the femur, and a heel strike, an axial force on the femur, can be performed to assess for possible femur fractures. Next, assess for any leg length discrepancy. To prevent loss of leg length due to pelvic rotation, ask the patient to raise the pelvis off the table and reposition before fully extending the legs. You want to measure the distance between the ASIS and the medial malleolus and compare the distance from one side to the other side. Next, evaluate active range of motion. If pain or limitation exists, repeats with passive range of motion. Check straight leg hip flexion, isolating the rectus femoris muscle. Then bent knee hip flexion, isolating the iliopsoas muscle. Also check resisted strength. Next, check internal rotation, external rotation, abduction, and resisted adduction. Palpate anatomic landmarks for tenderness, including the abdomen, to evaluate for abdominal fascial hernia, anterior superior iliac spine, anterior inferior iliac spine, the iliac crests, and pubic symphysis. A passive straight leg raise should be performed to evaluate for lumbar radiculopathy. The test is considered positive if the patient has reproduction of radicular symptoms before 70 degrees of hip flexion. Hamstring flexibility testing can also be performed with the hip and knee flexed to 90 degrees, followed by passive extension of the knee. Full extension is desired, but if not, the angle short of full extension is recorded. Thomas's test assesses for hip flexor contracture. One hip is maximally flexed to the patient's chest, flattening the lumbar spine. If the contralateral leg flexes at the knee and rises off the table, the test is positive. Patrick's or Faber test can be performed to evaluate for hip and sacroiliac pathology. One leg is flexed, abducted, and externally rotated in position, resting the foot on the other knee. If the leg does not lower into a position parallel to the exam table, there may be a hip flexor contracture or protective iliopsoas spasm. Pressure on the knee with counterpressure on the opposite pelvic brim may elicit pain at the hip or sacroiliac joint. In the lateral position, again test active range of motion and resisted strength for hip abduction and adduction. Palpate the greater trochanter of the femur, the iliotibial band, and the tensor fascia lata. Ober's test assesses for iliotibial band syndrome. With the patient in the lateral position, the knee is supported and flexed to 90 while the hip is slightly extended and abducted. When the examiner releases knee support, failure of the knee to adduct is considered a positive test. With the patient prone, complete testing of active range of motion with leg extension. Palpate anatomic landmarks for tenderness. The lumbar spine, the sacroiliac joint, the sacrum, the gluteus maximus muscle, the piriformis muscle, the sciatic notch, the ischial tuberosity, and the adductor tubercle of the proximal femur. The piriformis test evaluates for pain from sciatic nerve irritation caused by piriformis muscle. With the patient prone, the knees are flexed to 90 degrees and the hips are internally rotated. Provide resistance against external rotation. Reproduction of the pain is a positive test. Eli's test assesses for rectus femoris spasticity. With the patient prone, the examiner resists knee flexion. If the buttocks raise or the pelvic tilt appears, it is a positive test. In concluding the hip exam, it is important to document neurovascular exam. Here, dorsalis pedis artery, posterior tibial artery, and capillary refill testing are tested. Further neurovascular exam may be indicated by history.